praise and all the glory. I can remember 19 years ago, I was right about now in the hospital. I would say I was in recovery at this time 19 years ago. And Brianna was born 19 years ago today. I gave birth after 6, I think it was 6:47 in the morning after 22 and a half hours of labor. And so I give God praise. And many of you know our story. And our story was after 5 miscarriages, the Lord truly was amazing in the process and brought forth our firstborn. And today we celebrate her. Brianna, huge shout out to you. Thank you for making us mom and dad. And thank you for coming into this world and being so amazing. So we just want to celebrate you today. And yesterday, as I wrote the message, I thought about God's goodness. I thought about his loving kindness. And that's why this morning, when the song came and said, "Don't let a rock cry out in my place," I was like, "God, that's me. A rock will never cry out in my place. A rock will never give you glory. When I got breath in this body, a rock will never cry out in my place because you've been too good. You've been too awesome. You've been too magnificent to me for me to allow a rock to cry out in my place. Because God, even when I wasn't faithful, you were faithful to me. So this morning, excuse me if you see me just lifting up my hands to give him praise. Because I know in whom I believe. I know in whom I trust. And I give him all the glory. Hallelujah." And somebody said, "Well, it don't take all of that, Pastor Carleen." Yes, it does for me, it does. It takes all of that and then some. Because if you know what I've been through, my God, I can't help but to give him praise. If you knew how dire it was, my God, hallelujah, then he came in and how he blessed me, you would understand my praise. You will understand how I lift up hands and I don't care who is watching. I don't care when you see the tears streaming down my face because I know in whom I believe and I know in whom I trust. And as a result, I won't let a rock cry out in my place. As long as there is breath in this body, I will give him praise. So I pray this morning that as I echo those words, you will roll back the curtains and you will say, "God, I give you thanks. God, I worship and adore you because you've been too good to me for me to shut up my mouth, for me to keep my hands at my side, and I don't lift up holy hands unto you. Father, I thank you. I thank you because you've been too good. You've been too good." So, welcome one and all to Recharge Ministries, a place where the logos is action, where we're family centered, where purpose must be fulfilled, and where we have a servant heart. That's our tenets this morning. That's who we are. And there's a word from the Lord today. And the word is, when the word is sown, what happens? And the subtitle is, if you sow the seed God has given you, he will grow it because God can grow what we don't sow. When the word is sown, what happens? But then the subtitle is, if you sow the seed God has given you, he will grow it. Because God can grow what we don't sow. So, are you a sower this morning? Are you? That's a question for you to answer. Are you a sower this morning? Are you a sower this morning? The scripture was read, and it's Mark 4, 1 through 20. And it was already read for our scripture reading this morning. But I want to briefly just run over it. Again, he began to teach beside the sea, and a very large crowd gathered about him, so that he got into a boat and sat in it on the sea. And the whole crowd was beside the sea on the land, and he was teaching them many things and parables. And in his teaching, he said to them, "Listen, behold, a sower went out to sow. And as he sowed, some seed fell along the path, and the birds came and devoured it. Other seeds fell on rocky ground where it did not have much soil, and immediately it sprang up, since it had no depth of soil. And when the sun rose, it was scorched, and since it had no root, it withered away. Other seed fell among thorns, and the thorns grew up and choked it, and it yielded no grain. And other seeds fell into good soil and produced grain, growing up and increasing and yielding 30-fold, 60-fold, and 100-fold. And he said, "He who has ears to hear, let him hear." And when he was alone, those around him with the 12 asked him about the parables. And he said to them, "To you has been given the secret of the kingdom of God. But for those outside, everything is in parables, so that they may indeed see but not perceive, and may indeed hear but not understand, lest they should turn and be forgiven." And he said to them, "Do ye not understand this parable? How then will you understand all the parables?" The sower sows the word. The sower sows the word. And these are the ones along the path where the word is sown. When they hear, Satan immediately comes and takes away the word that is sown in them. And these are the ones sown on rocky ground. The one who, when they hear the word, immediately receive it with joy. And they have no roots in themselves, but endure for a while. Then when tribulation or persecution arises on account of the word, immediately they fall away. And others are the ones sown among them, among thorns. They are those who hear the word, but the cares of the world and the deceitfulness of riches and the desires of other things enter in and choke the word, and it proves unfruitful. But those that were sown on the good soil are the ones who hear the word and accept it and bear fruit 30-fold and 60-fold and 100-fold. Bless the Lord. Father, we just want to thank you this morning for your love. We want to thank you, Lord God, for being our source and our resource, God. And we thank you this morning for abiding with us. I pray this morning that as you increase and I decrease, Lord God, you will speak aloud, Father, to your children, Lord God. Through this message this morning, I pray that lives will be transformed and renewed. Lord God, I pray that the sower this morning, that as you come, Lord God, and pour in, Lord God, your children will receive your word and their lives will never, ever be the same, because you are the ultimate sower this morning. So God, as you sprinkle your seed, Lord God, among us, oh God, I pray, Lord God, that it will fall on good soil. Father God, this morning, I pray that it will fall on good soil. And I pray right now that as your word is reverberated throughout the earth, Lord God, through the extension of the digital platform, Lord, I pray that your children will say, "I receive," and my life will never, ever be the same again. We glorify your name and we seal this prayer right now in the name of the Father, the Son, and the blessed Holy Ghost. Amen and amen. Hallelujah. So the topic is when the word is sown. And the subtitle is, if you sow the seed God has given you, he will grow it. Because God can grow what we don't sow. God cannot grow what we don't sow. So I think I mentioned before that we're reading through the Bible, the Old and the New Testament together. And so, my God, passion is exuded. Passion is illuminated through the word of the Lord. Amen. So I went back to Genesis that I will pivot on over into Mark, where we read this morning, Mark 4. And I went back to the beginning. And the first gift God gave man after created man was dominion and authority. And that was stated in Genesis 1, verse 26. Then he gave man every herb bearing seed as the second gift. So say second gift. Then he gave man every herb bearing seed as the second gift, known as seed. And that was taken from Genesis 1, verse 29. Then God said, I give you every seed bearing plant on the face of the whole earth, and every tree that has fruit with seed in it. In other words, God gave us the authority to determine our course based on the seeds that we sow. Essentially, God said to Adam, I am giving you seed. And if you plant this seed, it will be for your provision. If you don't plant it, then it won't grow because you have nothing in the ground. If you eat it, then that's the end of your harvest. So it's up to you what you do with your seed this morning. So from Genesis, as you have seen, meaning Genesis is the beginning, God intended for man to be seed sowers. And Genesis 8 and verse 22 says that as long as the earth remains, seed time and harvest shall not cease. And the Apostle Paul further says, whatsoever a man soweth, that shall he also reap. Meaning a man's harvest depends entirely on the seed that he sows. In other words, everything in your life is a result of the seeds that you have sown. So God intended for you and I to be seed sowers, not just in finances, because I know where the mind is going this morning. I ain't touching on that. Because that's the first thing that we say, seed sowing, okay, it's finances. God intended for you and I to be seed sower, not just in finances, but in everything. In everything. Our words are seeds. Our actions are seeds. Our lifestyle is a seed. And when sowing is your lifestyle, God promises in 2 Corinthians 9 and 10 that he will always provide seed for the sower. When sowing is your lifestyle, God promises in 2 Corinthians 9 and 10 that he will always provide seed for the sower. And when you make up in your mind to be a seed sower every day of your life and always looking for an opportunity to sow seed, then God promises that sowers will never be without seed. You will never be without it if that is your lifestyle every single day. Because a seed sower is not just finances, but everything that you do, because it is your lifestyle. And I want you to know this morning that a sower in the Bible is not a part-time planter. They weren't. It's not on occasion, on a whim, when I felt like it. Because when Jesus talks about a sower, he's talking about a lifestyle of sowing.
And I don't know what you need this morning, but I do know this. You probably always will have seed for everything you need if you sow, if you become a seed sower. And if you will act on what God told Adam, that I'm giving you seeds, then you will get the kind of results that God promised. It's because when you got the seed, you just held on to it. But what did I say that my title was this morning, my subtitle? If you sow the seed God has given you, he will grow it. Because God can't grow what we don't sow. But what happens when the word is sown? And I'm staying on the word this morning. What happens when the word is sown? Because that's what Mark 4, 1 through 20 is all about. When the word is sown, what happens? Because how we listen to God really matters. It really matters. Because that's what Mark 4, 1 through 20 was all about. When the word is sown, because like I said, I'm not talking about finances. Because being a seed sower is a lifestyle. Everything that we do, it's in our words, it's in our actions, and it's our lifestyle. Because many of us get stuck in the finances. But it's everything. It embodies you. So when the word is sown, what happens? Because how we listen to God really matters. And I want you to catch this morning, because Adam and Eve were placed in the garden with a command to what? To listen. So from the beginning, God has always said, listen, because God's laws required careful listening. And further in the Old Testament, the daily prayers of God's people began with words of Deuteronomy 6, which says, hear, O Israel, the Lord our God, the Lord is one. And what happened, if you really have been reading, like I said, we're going through the Bible. Israel wandered in the desert for 40 years due to their failure to listen. They endured 400 years of God's silence because Christ came. Before Christ came, because they would not listen to his word. They endured 400 years of God's silence before Christ came because they would not listen to his word. So it should come as no surprise this morning when we pivot into the New Testament and Jesus opens his teaching in Mark 4, verse 3 with a command to listen. And listen is a very strong word. And what kind of word it is? It's a command word. Our attention is mandatory when somebody say, listen. And if you have your Bibles this morning, if you open it, you will see listen, explanation point. I'm calling attention to it. And our response to the command makes all the difference. That's a difference this morning. Listen. And Jesus knew in that very moment that not everyone gathered on that beach, on that sea, would really hear its message. He knew some had already made up their mind about who he was or wasn't. They were listening without listening, like many of you this morning. They were hearing without hearing. The words went in one ear and through the predetermined filter and landed on the rock hard surface of their hearts. For others, the hearing wasn't as dull. Life appeared to take root. But what began couldn't last. For yet others, the message bore fruit. Now, what made the difference? What really made the difference in all those scenarios? Because we all fit in one of those categories this morning. But to find the answer, we must look at this parable in two parts. And the two parts are, first, we must consider the sower who sows the seed. And the second, we must understand the types of soil that we're sowing in. So number one, the sower sows the seed. A sower went out to sow. What does he sow? That's a question. Jesus says in Mark 4, verse 14, the sower sows the word of God. And who is the sower? Is my next question. Well, the sower is anyone who sows the word of God. That sower is you and me. The preacher, the position I'm standing in this morning, the missionary in the third world country, the saint that's at lunch who talks to the co-worker, the parent telling the child the Bible bedtime story. It's the friend that sees another friend that's going off and about to jump over that decides to sow a word of comfort. It's the one that knows that this person is hurting and go and sow a word of healing in their lives. So the sower is anyone who shares God's word, spreading the seed as they go. It's that heavenly currency that needs to flow off our lips every single day, every minute of the day. But at the most fundamental level, Jesus is the sower, fulfilling and encompassing the totality of the role. He is, in the Apostle John's language, the word. He is the word. The word existed from the very foundation. It's God himself made manifest to us, as stated in John 1, verse 1. He spreads the seed of the word, calling all to repent and believe, for the kingdom of God is at hand. Now the next question is, how does the sower sow the seed? How do we do that? In the beginning verses of Mark 4, Jesus taught this parable on the shore for all to hear, sowing the seed of the word on all kinds of soil. The seed is spread indiscriminately, far and wide, on all kinds of ground. Some falls on the hard path. Some falls into good soil. But nonetheless, the field is covered. And the method of sowing is that the farmer sowed, then plowed. So he sprinkles, and then he plows. Some seed went to unproductive places. Some seed fell on the path. Some fell among rocks and thorns. But you see, the farmer couldn't make his field perfect before it's spreading. Sometimes what appears to be good soil turned out to be useless. But he spreads his seed throughout his field. Come on, take a walk with me. Imagine, sprinkles and then he spreads, doing what he could to prepare for an abundant harvest. Then he waited to see what the seed would yield. It. But the word of God talks about the four types of soil. And all of us fits into one of the buckets. So a question is asked. When the sower sows his or her seed, what will the seed find to rest on? Ah. What will the seed find to rest on? In other words, what kind of soil is your heart made of? What kind of soil is your heart made of? As such, Jesus presented four types of soil, but there are ultimately only two kinds. Even though he separated into four, there are ultimately only two. The soil of unfaith and the soil of faith. So do you believe or you don't? But whenever the seed of the word is sown, underscore this, all four types are present. And I'm going to go into the four. When the seed of the word is sown, all four types are present. Whenever the gospel is preached, there is no neutral response to God's word. There is either a negative or a positive response. And this truth is evident in this parable. And that's why we have four types of soil. Because there are different ways to respond to God's word. And this morning, we're all responding in some way. But you need to be the judge of your hearts. This morning, how are you responding to God's word? And I just love how Mark broke it down. Because when you hit on verses, Mark 4, verses 15 through 20, he broke it down. The 15th verse talks about the hard and dry. Verses 16 through 17 talks about the shallow and the rocky. Verses 18 through 19 talks about the crowded and the anxious. And then verse 20 is the soft and open soil. So let me talk to you about the different soil so that you can distinguish where are you this morning. So in verse 15, it says, and these are the ones along the path where the word is sown. When they hear, Satan immediately comes and takes away the word that is sown in them. Satan immediately comes and takes away the word that is sown in them. And the perfect example of this is we see the Pharisees in Mark's account with this kind of heart. They don't accept Jesus as their Lord. They oppose him as their enemy. The more Jesus speaks, the more he heals, the more he teaches, the harder their heart gets. Because they completely closed off Jesus. It's uninterested in hearing. They didn't want to hear him. So therefore, they were unable to hear him. And this is the natural man Paul speaks of, that it doesn't matter how religious they appear on the outside, their heart tells truth. Now, what happens to this kind of heart? When they hear, Satan immediately comes. These aren't my words. That's what the word of God said. Satan immediately comes and takes the word away. He snatches it up before it sinks in. But one prayer can do him in. Blessed be the Lord. One prayer can do it, Satan, this morning. That's why Peter tells us in 1 Peter 5, verse 8, be sober-minded, be watchful. Your adversary, the devil, prowls around like a roaring lion, seeking someone to devour. So every day, every minute, every second of the hour, my God, Satan is prowling around like a roaring lion, seeking someone to devour. Because when the word is sown, he immediately comes and takes away the word. Because Satan has a million methods of taking the seed away. Because he's really good at distracting us from God. But this morning, wherever you are, the distractions are real. Think about it. I want you to think about the distractions in life, and you don't necessarily call these distractions, but I'm going to call you into acknowledgement this morning. Doesn't the bed always feel better than the Bible? Isn't the conversations on social media more interesting than prayer time? Doesn't self-justification feel better than repentance? How I feel. Yes, it's me first. Isn't Netflix better than nightly meditation on God's word? Many of you right now are tempted to scroll through social media while the word is being preached. Many of you are thinking about the week already, instead of focusing on the word. Many of you are probably in the kitchen cooking. Many of you are probably doing other things all at the same time instead of listening to the word. Now, where do you think all of that comes from? Exactly what I said. Satan is roaming, prowling, seeking whom he may devour. He's seeking someone to devour. And all these are devices that we don't think are devices and methods are just that. He's taking you away from the word of God so that the word cannot sink into you. Because when the word is sown, he's going to soup on it. That's what the word says. And when you're distracted, that's a method. Because it's his million methods of taking the seed away so that it doesn't sink in. Our job is not to let him. Our job is to be watchful. And if you sense a hardness in your heart, please consider that's perhaps the reason why you are here today. It's for Christ to grind that stone away. It's time for him to chip away at your heart, to remove the callous. The hard surface has hardened your heart. And it's time to chip it away. And since the parables came from the mouth of Jesus, they contain the power to open up every ear. The Bible says faith comes from hearing, and hearing through the what Romans 10 verse 17 says. Faith comes from hearing, and hearing through the word of Christ. Second is the shallow and the rocky. Verse 16 and 17 says, and these are the ones sown on rocky ground. The ones who, when they hear the word, immediately receive it with joy. And they have no root in themselves, but endure for a while. Then when tribulation or persecution arises on account of the word, immediately they fall away. We see in the word this kind of heart in the crowds that follow Jesus. And like X, formerly known as Twitter, followers that see the trending, they jump on the bandwagon. In Jamaica, we call it the wagoness. They jump on the bandwagon who is popular today. And they love him for his miracles. That's what the Bible says. But leave him for his exclusive claims. They don't stick with him because their heart just isn't open enough. They say they believe but don't endure. Proving they don't really believe. They're merely interested in the hot and trending things because you're up in this moment, because everybody likes you right now. Everyone is on the bandwagon with you. But when following him, they get uncomfortable. Inconvenience step in. Discouragement step in. He's too risky, so they leave. They didn't sign up for hardship. Like many of you are saying, I didn't sign up for this. When I was in sin, I was good. But since I turned the page, since I changed partners, my life got hard. So I didn't sign up for this hardship. That's the shallow and the rocky heart. This is the kind of heart that treats Jesus not as the Savior he really is, but as the spiritual pixie dust or microwave that we want. We want a quick fix. But when the talks get going, we bail out. This is the kind of heart that treats Jesus as a guru to give us life tips, as a genius bar to fix our broken toys, as our spiritual co-pilot to bless our not so bad life. It happens when we treat him only as the positive and encouraging Jesus who never steps on our toes, never calls us out for our lack of commitment, never asks us to deny ourselves and take up the cross and follow him. As long as I don't call you out, then we're good. This is the shallow and the rocky heart. As long as Jesus don't step on my toes, we're good. And with this heart, things are good for a while, but because we're never considered his words, and because we never chewed on it, and we have never really thought it through, and we have kept it shallow, it dies in us because we're surface people. Because when things get tough, we leave him for something else. Something else that's nice and shiny. Something else that's not going to cause my heart to question if this is good or bad. Now, when we treat Jesus in mere pragmatic terms, as soon as he no longer works for us, we look for someone else that will. This is the heart that's tried. That's tried Jesus and found that he's just all right, but not all right enough. Is that you? Is that me? Then there's a third. The crowded and the anxious heart. Verse 18 and 19 says, and others are the ones sown among thorns. And they are those who hear the word. But the cares of the world and the deceitfulness of riches and the desires for other things enter in and choke the word. And it proves unfruitful. And it proves unfruitful. So this kind of art is just too crowded, too much going on. It has too many things at the same level of importance. You hear me? This is the kind of art. It's just too crowded because too many things are at the same level of importance. This one is a major danger zone, blazing red for me. I call it the blazing red. And the sad part is our culture is most prone to this one. It upholds social status, comfort and security, and personal desires alongside the things of God, all at the same level, because everything is at the same level of importance. It's the heart of the anxiety. You're worried about things out of our control because we have to let so many things control us because we have too many competing loves inside. Lichen, my God. You see how the Senate and the House of Representatives are all arguing? It's like the boardroom, I call it. Everything is colliding. We're arguing, we're debating, we're voting all at the same time, consistently agitated, divided, and upset, and rarely coming to a decision. This is a crowded ending and the anxious heart because too many things are competing interests and at the same level of importance. Because you know what? With this heart, their reputation matters. They grow anxious about what is said. Everything they're juggling. They're multitaskers that juggles everything all at the same time. And everything has the same weight of importance. And the Bible calls it the crowded and anxious heart. Is that you? And the fourth and final is a soft and open heart. Verse 20 says, but those that were sown on the good soil are the ones who hear the word and accept it and bear fruit 30-fold and 60-fold and 100-fold. If we're looking for similarities, this is the heart of Jesus' disciples. They accepted his word. They followed him when it's hard. They stick with him when they didn't understand necessarily. They drew near. They leaned in. They wanted Jesus. And to them are given the secrets of the kingdom of God. That's what the word said. That's not mine. And to them are given the secrets of the kingdom of God. They get not only knowledge of his kingdom, they get his kingdom. Not just knowledge of it, but they get his kingdom. They enter the experience. They had an encounter. That's why every morning we gather together, you are going to get an experience and an encounter because they entered the experience. The soft and open heart is a heart that every Christian should desire to have. It is a heart that has accepted Christ and listened, the command, listened to his word. So what kind of soil is your heart? Is it hard and dry? Is it shallow and rocky? Is it crowded and anxious? Or soft and open? Is our heart unfaithful? Or do you have a heart of faith? So how do we know what kind of heart? Because not many of us are aware. So how can we know? Because not everyone in Christ will yield a hundredfold. Not everyone. You saw the parable. But all in Christ will yield something. Even though we will not yield a hundredfold, but all in Christ will yield something. And it's the way we know the seed has taken root in our life. The seed sown in good soil bears fruit. There's a bearing of fruit. So the answer is look at the fruit. The three soils mentioned before, the hard and dry, the shallow and rocky, the crowded and anxious, these are bad soil. And then it's a soft and open, the soil is good. And even if it looks good on the surface, the fruit is all that matters. The fruit is what matters. What does your fruit yield? So the major question here this morning is, how do we get the good soil? How do we get by being a good person? Because good by what standards? Because my standard and your standard might be very different. Do we get it by removing the rocks underneath? If so, then how can we see down far enough to remove those rocks? Do we get it by pulling out the weeds in our lives? If so, how can we be sure we got out the root of those weeds? Self-care won't produce what we need, because that's another word today that's going viral, self-care. Because we can never be good enough. We can never remove all the rocks. We can never pull out enough weeds. So we need another way, because all of this, there is never going to be enough. But in John 12, verse 24, as Jesus makes a turn towards Jerusalem and ultimately the cross, he tells his disciples about his upcoming death by saying, "Truly, truly, I say to you, unless a grain of wheat falls into the earth and dies, it remains alone. But if it dies, it bears much fruit. Truly, truly, I say to you, unless a grain of wheat falls into the ground and dies, it remains alone. But if it dies, it bears much fruit." What is Jesus saying? He's saying the power of the gospel is in its death. The power of the gospel is a seed planted in the ground. Jesus is not only the sower, he's got seed. And the fruit we need grows out of his death and resurrection. What is a seed really that powerful? Is your next question. But those that are analytic, can it really break hard sinners? I ask the question again. Is a seed really that powerful? To humanity, a seed is so weak you can crush it. And that's what Satan thought he did to Jesus on the cross. But not one of his bones were broken. I must let you know this morning. My God. Oh, my God. Easter is coming. So I'm gearing up. Oh, my God. But that's what Satan thought he did to Jesus on the cross. But I'm here to announce to you, but not one of his bones were broken. In his death, Jesus wasn't a crushed seed. My God, he was a planted seed. My God. Hallelujah. My God, Jesus wasn't a crushed seed. He was a planted seed. He fell into the earth and died. And 3 days later, his power was released. Why did Jesus become a seed? A theologian said that if he came with a sword, he would cut us to pieces. If he came with fire, he'll burn us to ashes. So he came as a seed to be planted for us. To be planted for us. That's a secret of the kingdom this morning. When you hear that, something must happen deep inside of you. Your heart, a stone, cracks open to Jesus. And once he's inside, his word grows and grows. There's a power that comes into your life. It's the power of the seed, the power of the word of God, the power of the sower. And it has the power to transform the soil. The power of the seed. He came as a seed to be planted for us. The secret. That's it. Many of you that read Mark 4 that just couldn't comprehend. That's it this morning. He came as a seed to be planted. And once he's inside, his word grows and grows. And there's a power that comes into your life. That's the power of the seed, the power of the word of God, and the power of the sower. The power to transform the soil of your heart, my heart. We were all born sinners. Separated from God. But that seed is more powerful than our unbelief. I pray this morning that you are looking at Jesus in a different way. I pray that you receive the seed that's sown. No matter where your heart was, the four different buckets. Because as I said, all of us are represented this morning. Because this morning, the seed of the gospel is being sown. Pray that you want him this morning, the seed that's sown. Pray that the way you came this morning, you will leave a different way because of the seed sown. Because God broke something inside of you. If you were torn between two thoughts, pray this morning that your heart is settled. Pray that he draws you
close this morning. God, to see this song.
And it started long before today. God, today was your divine appointment to hear this word. When God planted the trees at creation, he had the cross in mind. God planted the trees at creation. He had the cross in mind. When the first seed died, the resurrection was already planted. Because when your heart cracks open to Jesus, your salvation was already sealed in eternity. That's the kind of God we have. One who loves us enough to break us. He sent his only begotten son to die to save us. And who arose to give us eternal life. That's a God that we serve. So this morning he's saying, what happens when the seed is sown? What happens? He gave me a seed. God has given me a seed. And I'm sowing it. Everywhere I go, his words reverberates from me. I'm sowing that seed. And I pray this morning that the seed that's sown, you will listen. Because behold, the sower, which is Jesus Christ, went out and sowed. Allow the seed to fall into your heart so that you might and will receive him today. Father, this morning, I thank you. I thank you that you are the ultimate sower. And I thank you for sowing your seed this morning into our hearts. I pray this morning, Lord God, that the devourer did not soup it, but we were watchful and mindful of your word. And we let the word sink into our hearts and take root in our heart, Lord, so that our lives will be transformed and renewed for your glory. We thank you this morning, God, for what you're doing. The transformation that will come. The manifestation of your word that will burst forward. I pray, Lord God, that today, Lord God, lives are transformed and renewed. I pray this morning that those that came, not knowing what they were about to encounter, had an encounter and an experience with you. I pray that this experience and encounter will be the bridge that they cross over, Lord. And they have placed their hand in your hand. Father, this morning, the prodigal son that returned home, we thank you, Lord God, this morning in rejoicement over that soul that says, I've wandered so far away from you, but I'm coming home. It's that daughter that's been wayward and wandering to and fro, couldn't find rest. This morning she will say, I yield, I yield. I am a royal diadem. I am your child, Lord. Oh God, you're going to give me beauty for ashes this morning, Lord. My heart will be transformed and will be renewed. The beauty that you'll place on the inside will come on the outside. You will adorn me, oh God, this morning. Because, Lord God, your seed has fell upon open ground. And so, Lord God, my heart is open to you. Father, for the one that has so much going on, where everything has equal importance, Lord, I pray this morning that we take out the clutter and we keep our eyes fixed on you. Because your word said that those that seek the kingdom of God first, then all things shall be added unto us. So this morning when we place you at the highest, when we seek you, God, naturally everything else falls in line. Teach us to understand and know that when we focus on you, when you're at the core, when you're at the center of it all, Lord God, and when we place you first, then naturally you bless us with all the other things that we need. So Lord, help us to focus and realign our thoughts, our mind, our hearts. Place it all on you. Give us a heart like thine this morning, Lord. Let us pursue you in all that we're doing. Let us be focused and resolute on you, Lord. Father, I pray this morning for every heart that hears this word, that it will fall on open soil, soft soil, so that it's receptive to your word and it will bear much fruit. I thank you, Lord God, for the fruitfulness that will birth forward this morning. I thank you for the transformed lives that will never be the same. I thank you, Lord, and I seal this prayer right now in the name of the Father, the Son, and the blessed Holy Ghost. Amen and amen. My name is Pastor Carleen Hepburn here at Recharge. Just want to thank you for listening this morning. My assignment is real. And this morning, when the word is sown, what happens? What happens to you? What happens to me? Because if you sow the seed that God has given you, he will grow it. He will grow it. Because the reality is God can't sow. God cannot grow what we don't sow. So you got to put something in the ground. So sow your seed this morning, the seed that God has given unto you. Because when the word is sown, what happens? May God bless and keep you. And I pray that this word seep into your heart and seep into your spirit. God bless you. Have an amazing week in the Lord. It's a brand new week. What are you going to do with this brand new week? What are you going to do when the word is sown? Don't let the devourer takes it away. But I pray this morning that it fell into that open, soft heart of yours. Listen. Behold, a sower went out. So, and that sower is Jesus Christ this morning, and he's sowing seeds into your soil. God bless you.